So let's do this. Troy Hunt.
Thank you. Wow, that's awesome. I've not had an intro like that. Thanks, Jim. So Jim asked me to come and do this conference, and he said, like it's Hawaii, you can be really relaxed and casual and be all sort of Australian. And I said, all right, I'll come and I'll wear my boardies and my thongs and it'll be really nice. And Jim paused for a long time after I said that. I don't know why. Then he got very excited about me turning up in my thongs. Is that a Hawaiian thing? They're right here. But this, we don't need to be formal about this, so I can chuck over there. Is that why everyone's been looking at me funny? What does it mean here?
No,
don't. All right, so why don't we just start off with something lighthearted, because this is meant to be a fun conference. So I went and pulled a little bit of information from the internet about how all this hacking stuff happens. And I know there's a lot of security pros here, and you will look at this and go, yes, I understand this is exactly how it works. So let's jump straight into that.
No way. I'm getting hacked.
A port scan?
No, this is major. They've already burned through the NCIS public firewall.
We'll isolate the node and dump them on the other side of the router.
I'm trying. It's moving too fast.
Oh, this is not good. We're using our connection to the Infos database. Sever it.
I can't. It's a point attack. He or she is only going after my machine.
It's not possible. This is DoD level 9 encryption. It would take months to get built.
Hey, what is that, video game?
No, Tony, we're getting hacked.
They get in Abby's computer. The entire NCIS network is next.
I can't stop him. Do something, McGee.
I've never seen code like this. Way to go, Abby.
I didn't do anything. I thought you did.
No.
I did.
I think the reason why I like this is I like looking at the public perception of what it is that many of us here do, because it's represented in a totally incommensurate way. I mean, we all know that it's actually a lot more like this, where there's a guy with a hoodie, maybe some gloves. Turn the lights down, you know, it's like a very intimate hacking moment. So we see this, and I'm going to come back to this later on as well, right? That the way that the press represents security and hacking and everything else to the public. But I guess what I really want to speak about today is this sort of concept of everyone being pwned. And I want to sort of talk about some of the things we can do as builders and as we're constructing systems as well to try and do things better, and to try and separate some of the FUD I think we have in the industry at the moment as well. Now, on the pwned side, obviously a lot of this has to do with this system, which Jim just mentioned before. Who's used Have I Been Pwned? All right, awesome. So just about everyone. So who's been in, say, the LinkedIn data breach? Not many LinkedIn users. Interesting. Dropbox? Ashley Madison? Just Jim. So every time I ask this question, I know the data, come on, you can't hide. It's always a guy too. So one of the things we learned out of the Ashley Madison data breach was that there are a huge number of signups of women from IP address 127.0.0.1. Something not quite right there. So we actually found that they were creating bots, or I think they called them engagers. Like, bots is a nasty word. So it said they're engagers. They're effectively machine code that will talk mostly to men to try and get them interested, and then they'll pay money. And I'm thinking about all these guys who then need to explain to their partners that, yes, I was on Ashley Madison and I was having all of these intimate chats, but don't worry, it was just with a computer. So we learned some funny things. Now, one of the things that I have found very interesting with this system is by using the word pwned, a lot of people get confused, right? Like a lot of normal, everyday folks. And the other folks that get confused about this is the press. So the press will sort of say, oh, you know, we've got this system called pwned. What does pwned mean? And it's a fair question. And in fact, I've had some people say you shouldn't call it that because it creates confusion. People don't know what it means. I think it's the other way around. I think that not knowing what it means actually makes it kind of fun, because a lot of people get interested and they go, well, what does this mean? So it's kind of one of those things that's hard to explain. But to visually represent it, pwned can be many things. This would be one way of being very pwned, which is, I think we can agree on that. In Australia, if you get pwned, it looks a lot more like this guy just here. You know everything's trying to kill you in Australia, don't you? Very pwned. To put it in a more sort of infosec-centric representation, another way to be pwned would be to be a reporter doing an interview about your Twitter account being pwned and then having all your passwords on the wall behind you. That would also be very pwned. So lots of different interpretations. So I try and explain it in kind of a fun way, and personally I think it kind of makes it a little bit more interesting. Now, a lot of what I've been doing with Have I Been Pwned relates to passwords. Because obviously when we talk about data breaches, we're talking about big systems like LinkedIn, Dropbox, Ashley Madison, getting breached, people's credentials spread everywhere. So over the last sort of 4 and a bit years of running this, I've seen literally billions of different accounts and passwords. And I thought one of the things that would be interesting to talk about for a bit is how authentication has evolved and where we're going with it and what's really changing. So I like this picture because this picture is MIT in the 60s. And this is their compatible time-sharing system. And the reason I got it here is that this is believed to be the first implementation of a password on a computer system. Now, when we think about risks and threats to authentication in the 60s, when the computer is like a whole room, right? Think about what you need for an adversary to gain access to an account. You've got to have physical access, number one. You've got to know what you're doing once you get in there. I'd have no, like honestly, I think if I walked into that, and I dare say most of us, we walked into this room, we'd be like, okay, I've got no idea where to start now. So there's that, and then we think about the way people would have created passwords then, in terms of what would be considered secret. You're not gonna have a whole bunch of other people know your dog's name because there's no social media, there's no sharing of this information. They're probably not gonna know your birth date, not to the extent that people do today, because you're not putting it even on your Twitter profile. So many people have their birth date on their Twitter profile. So your secrets are a very, very different proposition back then, 50 years ago, to what they are today. So physical access, actually knowing how to use the system, and then knowing what the credentials may be. But the interesting thing is that when you think about authentication then, it's pretty much the same as what it is for the vast majority of websites today, which is there are two strings, some are in the system, and there are two strings in someone's head, username and password. And if you can get these right, you'll be able to authenticate. Job done, right? And most of the time today, this is what authentication still is. Except what's happened is since the 60s, we've had really, really fundamental changes in information systems. Obviously, they don't look like this anymore. Now, a good example is if we fast forward about 2 decades into the 80s, we started getting connected systems within the home. So things like this. This is a Prestel. And Prestel was a very early days, early generation system where you could dial up via a modem, remote into a system, had about 90,000 users. And there's a little video clip here where they show you back in the 80s what it's like to use a Prestel and log on. So check this out.
The Prestel computer is now asking me to enter my own personal password, which I've now done.
Everyone see the problem? Okay, we'll go back, we'll zoom, enhance, slow it all down. Let's see how we feel about this. So this is the problem that we have with passwords. People will fall down to the lowest common allowable denominator. And now we've starting to have a bit of a problem, right? Because this is no longer like a computer in a room where you need physical access. This is something which is remotely accessible. And it's worldwide. And if you can dial in and guess someone's password, and you know they're going to fall down to that lowest common denominator, we've got a problem. So that was the 80s, you know, that was sort of 20 years in. Go another 20 years in, and now we're into sort of the noughties era. So now we're getting a time where we've got a huge number of connected systems. And it's no longer like 90,000 people connected to the internet. It's like 90 million. And obviously that's gone a lot higher since. So the problem we've got now is we're saying, okay, we've got all of these people from all around the world, and any of them can connect to any website and try to authenticate. Password of 1234, not so good. So what are we going to do? We're going to make complexity rules. And there's a little bit of archival footage here of Bob in accounting, and Bob is trying to create a password on a site, and the password needs to have a lowercase, needs to have an uppercase, needs to have a number, also needs to have a non-alphanumeric character. It's got to be at least 8 characters long. It can't be a password that he has used any time within the last 3 password rotation cycles, which is every 3 months. And Bob is losing his freaking mind because suddenly creating passwords is actually really, really difficult. And we all have this, right, where we've been to a site and you're trying to create a good password and it's like, you can't have this, you can't have that, you've got to have these other things, and it becomes a nightmare. So what we see next is people trying to circumvent the technology constraints with a bit of human logic. So people go, okay, what I'll do is I'll create a password like this. And this is cool because it meets all the criteria. Uppercase, lowercase, number, non-alphanumeric, 15 characters long. And this is a good password, right? No one's really enthusiastic about this. So we know as humans looking at this that it's a terrible password because it is a predictable pattern or a predictable collection of words. But it meets the mathematical criteria. And you can go into just about any enterprise today and create a password like this because it has satisfied everything they need. And there is a compliance officer somewhere that says, well, we've got criteria, and it meets the criteria. Check the box, everyone's authenticated, awesome. And I know people create passwords like this because I've seen all their passwords. They're exactly this sort of thing when they have to try and get around complexity rules. And then the next problem is, particularly in the enterprise, they'll create this password, and then what's going to happen in 3 months? It's like, a hacker could have got your password, you should change it. So they do this. And again, I know they do this because I see them in these data breaches. And they just keep rotating them over and over again. And the cool thing is so you get to the point where you can take that last number in the password, divide it by 4, and that's how long they've been at the company. And you can consistently and reliably do this. Now, there's a little bit of this which I kind of like insofar as, isn't it cool that the humans always find a way around the technology? You know, like when it gets in the way, they will find a way of solving this. But the problem, of course, is that these are not good passwords. They meet the criteria and they check the boxes, but they leave us vulnerable. So one of the things which I think is really cool is the way we're starting to change our perceptions of what creates good passwords and good password management. And I want to give you a good example of this. So the NCSC, which is the National Cybersecurity Centre in the UK, these guys create a whole heap of really, really cool, useful resources for individuals and for companies. And this is, I think we all get a bit jaded by government, right? We're like, our government is 10 years behind and has got screwy advice. This is a government department that actually does some really, really cool, useful stuff. So recently, just last year actually, they came out with some guidance and they said, you should only ask users to change their password on indication of suspicion of compromise. Because what they're saying is that if an adversary gets a password, it's not like they get the password and they go, oh, I could hack the account, but I got meetings, I'm busy. I'll come back in like 3 months, you know, after it's been changed. We're worried about account takeovers right away. And the other thing they've said is, what you'll find is that when you create rules that get in the way of people doing their job, and rotation rules do that, what's going to happen is people take shortcuts. So they'll make foolish decisions about the strength of their passwords or about the way they record their passwords. And we saw a really good representation of that recently. So let's put a Hawaiian slant on it. So, Hawaii's emergency response centers in January. Remember they sent out that accidental alert? It's like, you're all going to get bombed. Oh, no, sorry, we made a mistake. And afterwards, they're interviewing this bloke, and he's sitting there in his office, and there's something really, really alarming down here on the screen. They're using Internet Explorer. Oh, and also, they had their password posted on Post-it-Note. And this is the problem, right? Because this is what people will do. It's like, the password is hard to remember, we need to share it with people. What's the best way of doing that? We'll use like ghetto password management. We just whack it on Post-it notes. And this is the sort of thing that the NCSC is referring to, where they're saying people will take shortcuts which weaken their security. There is a human factor which the mathematics doesn't factor in. So there's a whole bunch of stuff that's really sort of fundamentally changing with the view of how we create passwords. And I'll give you an example here. There's a really good resource. I think it's a good resource. that I wrote a little while ago. Got the same bloke from MIT. And it's around passwords evolve. So how should we actually change the way we're doing passwords? And in this post, I talked a lot about the guidance from the NCSC, also guidance from NIST. So NIST has come out with some really cool stuff last year. And one of the things they actually said here, they talk about corpuses down here. And they say, what you should be doing is also having like a blacklist of bad passwords. So for example, passwords obtained from previous breach corpuses. Now also, in fairness, when they say having blacklists of passwords, they say, for example, you shouldn't allow people to sign up to your website using the name of the website. And that sounds crazy, but just as an example, things like the Cloud Pets data breach. So Cloud Pets, like little connected teddy bears, store children's voices in the cloud. What could go wrong? When you create your account on Cloud Pets, you can use a password of Cloud Pets. So a heap of people did. They stored them as bcrypt hashes, but as soon as you have a dictionary with Cloud Pets in it, a whole bunch of them fall anyway. Incidentally, their password requirement was you must have a character. Any character, as many as you like, it doesn't matter. So NIST has said, okay, don't allow that sort of stuff, like the sort of passwords that are named after the site, and also don't allow passwords which have previously been exposed. But NIST doesn't then say, here are the passwords that have been exposed. This is not really the government's job to do that. So one of the things I launched and Have I Been Pwned a little while ago was Pwned Passwords. And this went out in August, and there was about 320 million passwords that you could download and say, well, these are the ones that have appeared in data breaches. Back last month, just the month before, actually, about 6 weeks ago, I launched version 2, and there's just over 500 million passwords in here which have come from previous data breaches. They're not associated to any identities, so you can't sort of go, well, this is, you know, this person's password. But there's a big list where you can say these are the ones that we don't want people using. There's an API to it. I worked with Cloudflare on an anonymity model so that you can actually submit partial hashes of the password without disclosing the whole thing. Or you can just go and download the whole lot for free. This has worked out really, really well. I'm really impressed with how many people have adopted this. So now there's a bunch of services out there where if someone tries to create a password and it's appeared in a data breach, the service is saying either don't let him use it at all, and each password's got a prevalence, right? So how many times have we seen it? If we've seen it 10,000 times, probably not such a good password. Some of them are saying, well, maybe you shouldn't use this, maybe you should choose another one, you guys decide, because we've only seen it 10 times before. But I like this because it helps address that NIST requirement of how are we going to try and reduce the use of passwords we know have already been exposed. So that's been kind of useful. I'm quite happy with the way that's gone. On a very sort of different thread, one of the things that I think is particularly interesting at the moment is to look at how we're dealing with the likes of this, with WhatsApp. Now, this is a discussion between my wife and the other year two mothers in my son's class. And I think most of the folks know here that one of the things that happens when you use WhatsApp is you get end-to-end encryption. And of course, you all know that because this is green, it's encryption. That's what we've learned from the media. But this is a good thing, right, for everyday consumers. We will get end-to-end encryption, privacy by default, no manual sharing of keys or anything like that. It just happens and it's magic. The thing that we're obviously now dealing with is that we've got to figure out how do we give people the ability to have privacy and anonymity, but at the same time, how do we recognize that it can be used in bad ways? Now, one of the challenges that this creates is for government. And I'll give you a really good example here. So this is Amber Rudd. She's the Home Secretary in the UK. And recently, this whole encryption debate blew up again. And I'm sure it blows up in all your parts of the world as well, where someone from the government says, we've either got to backdoor it or technology companies have got to find a way to give us access, or we've got to somehow weaken the mechanisms that give people protection so that we can find the bad guys. And if I'm honest, I don't have a problem with the sentiment of there needs to be lawful ways of catching the people that we don't want blowing stuff up or whatever it may be. But of course, the problem that leads to then is how do we weaken the encryption? So Amber Rudd recently came out and said, well, normal people don't need it. Telling my wife that when she's having a nice WhatsApp chat. It's not that she's worried about the NSA getting in and seeing the fact that dads are going to play dodgeball, but to sort of say that normal people don't need this stuff. And this is exactly what she said. Real people don't need encryption. Like, this is a direct quote. And it feels so icky. And there are a lot of other things she said in that interview along very, very similar lines. And I guess the hesitation I have with this is that it's not just her, because we've got other world leaders saying really stupid shit at the moment. It's not a Trump thing, don't worry, he's not the only one. So, I'll give you a good example. So this bloke just here, this is our Prime Minister, a guy called Malcolm Turnbull, and he was recently having a very similar discussion with Amber Rudd was, like, we as law enforcement need access to information because we've got to try and be able to do our job. So he's having this interview here, this press release with the AFP, our federal police, and someone in the audience said, well, Malcolm, encryption is just mathematics, right? So how are you going to ban the law of mathematics if you're thinking about somehow trying to intercept communications? And our Prime Minister had a very good explanation for this.
The laws of mathematics are very commendable, but the only law that applies in Australia is the law of Australia.
So, first of all, in case there is anyone here who felt that their world leader, I don't know where you may be from, says some stupid stuff. And it's a totally baseless argument, because it's like saying, because in Australia we have too many drop bear attacks, the laws of gravity are going to be superseded by the laws of Australia. Like, this is like an immutable law. You can't just go along and say it doesn't apply and we've got some human-constructed legal thing that's going to supersede it. So it's one of these things where clearly the folks right at the top are kind of not getting the picture, and I think the folks beneath them, I'm sure there's some really, really smart people in government beneath Malcolm who are just going, oh God, I wish you hadn't said that, because now we've got to bear the brunt of it. But I think on the encryption side of things, there's a bit of a double-edged sword, because there's other aspects of encryption where I think almost everyone is pretty happy with the way we're moving forward. And a really good example of that is this. Now, there's an interesting story about this. So most of you guys will look at this and go, yeah, well, it's a padlock. I was speaking to some people at Mozilla recently, and they said in their focus groups, a huge number of people actually think this is a handbag. And when you think about it, you're like, actually, it does look. And now I've ruined it for you, right? Because every time you go to an HTTPS site, you're going to go, oh, it's a handbag. And, you know, it's like you were going to do some shopping, so, of course, you needed your handbag and your money. Anyway. So, put another way, we think of it like this. And this is the indicator in Chrome at the moment. And we see secure, and we go, okay, well, great, the site's secure. And it's just an interesting thought process to look at the visual indicator and think about what it means. Because the challenge that we're having now is that most of us here will understand that this means we've got an HTTPS connection. And when we have that connection, we're going to have confidentiality and integrity and all these wonderful things, which is great. But of course, your average everyday person is looking at it going, ah, secure, fantastic. So when I go to this website and it says secure, everyone's happy, yeah? Not much enthusiasm for happiness on this one. Because we're looking at this and going, well, there's something else going on here. And of course, this is a phishing site. And it is served over HTTPS, as many phishing sites now are. And one of the interesting things that I'm seeing a lot is people getting very upset about phishing sites having padlocks. Because they're saying, well, now people will go there and they will trust the site more than if it didn't have the padlock. And that's actually a reasonable thing to say, because we've been trying to condition people to this for a very long time as well. And of course, what's sort of accelerating the rate at which we see padlocks, handbags, whatever, on phishing sites is the likes of Let's Encrypt. Who's using Let's Encrypt, by the way? All right, a fairly sizable whack of this room. When I go to developer conferences, it's normally only a small number of people. And then you sort of go, did you know that you can get this for free and that it's automated and that it's an open implementation that your hosting provider can model this into their processes? And Let's Encrypt is making a hell of a big difference to the rate at which everyone gets HTTPS. Good people, bad people. It's a little bit like the end-to-end encryption argument. It's fantastic for privacy, whether you're having a discussion about good things or a discussion about bad things. So this is great in terms of the adoption rate, but it's now leading us to some new problems. One of the problems is, because it's free, there are entities out there that are not so happy about it. So you think about what that means if you have been in the business of selling certificates. A lot of organizations selling certificates that don't particularly like the fact that these guys have been doing it for free. Now, let me try and put this into context. I wrote something a little while ago around, particularly around EV. So we're going to come back to EV in a moment. Phishing sites, etc. Now, one of the sort of popular misconceptions is that the phishing site problem is all Let's Encrypt. Like, it's Let's Encrypt issuing all the certificates. They're the ones with the issues. There was an interesting chat that I had with this bloke. This is Malai. And Malai, I won't try and pronounce his last name, but Malai is the CEO of Komodo. And Komodo has been the largest issuing CA. So Let's Encrypt is now issuing more certs than Komodo. It's amazing what free will do in terms of your market uptake. So Komodo's been massive, and Komodo has not been real happy about phishing sites using certificates. And in fairness, what he said here is totally correct. So he's actually pointing out that Netflix site I just showed you. And he's saying, see the secure logo? When you see the secure logo, people will trust it more. They will fall for phishing attacks more. Now, there's an interesting thing that happened after that. And if we scroll down a little bit, we'll see that Malai talks about another one down here. So there's another embedded tweet where he said, look, here's another one. Of course my data's secure with these phishers. But this embedded tweet looks different to the previous embedded tweet. Anyone know why these tweets would look different if they're both embedded? Because this one's been deleted. Why would he delete it? Let's go and have a look at the site. So here's the site. It's the one I just showed you. And here's the issuing CA. So this is sort of where we get to separate the FUD. And in fact, just before I show you, there's a nice comment from here. So Eric Lawrence, he's the creator of Fiddler. Eric has a very, very good understanding of the mechanics of these things. He said, look, if you work at a CA and you need a phishing site to make a point, choose one for which a competitor supplied the certificate. Now, this is not just to beat up on Malai. It's not the point to sort of go, look, Komodo, you're always wrong, etc. I think they are oftentimes. But the point is that it's not just a Let's Encrypt thing. And if we go and have a look at the Netcraft stats of who's actually been issuing certificates to phishing sites, Komodo was winning. And incidentally, I think this is probably more like golf, where winning really needs to be you've got to have a lower figure. But they were issuing a huge number of certificates to phishing sites, because they've been doing the same thing in terms of issuing certificates for free. And what we've got to qualify now is that these are DV certificates. They're domain validation certificates. And occasionally you get people pop up and they say, well, Let's Encrypt or Komodo shouldn't issue certificates to phishing sites. And then you sort of go, well, why not? And they'll say, well, because the phishing site is evil. And then you go down this rabbit hole of who should be the judge of evil. So is it the CA's responsibility to figure out whether you're going to be a nice person or not? These are DV certs. This is, you control the domain. They're not DV certs and you're a nice person, right? Like, there is no nice person criteria. And the reality of it is that we have a lot of other controls to sort of deal with this nice person aspect of it. So you'll see Google Safe Browsing, you'll see ISPs picking up phishing sites. All this happens whether it's HTTP or HTTPS. So the argument of CAs playing the police, I don't think is a particularly good one. And frankly, a lot of the time when we see CAs, particularly the commercial CAs, getting upset about this, I think it's more an issue of being concerned about market loss. Because it used to be you'd pay $70 a year, and then they're issuing hundreds of thousands of certificates, and then suddenly that market evaporates. They're not going to be so happy about that. Now, getting back to the slides for a sec, one of the sort of areas this leads us to is around how confident can we be in identity. And this is a valid argument, it's a valid discussion to have. So as an example, we'll pick this site. Now for most people, we'd look at this and we go, it's Apple, right? It says Apple, we've got a padlock, everyone's happy. Now this is in Firefox. If we bring in the tab for that domain, a lot less happy because it's a homograph. And when we have a look at this in Chrome, it looks very different. But there's sort of a really interesting discussion here, which is, okay, there's the way Firefox renders homographs as opposed to the way that they, the way IDN, so internationalized domain names, would be rendered in Chrome. And just to sort of put it in perspective, so everyone knows there's no tricks here, if we go and take that, so this is in Chrome, we're seeing just what we did before, we jump into Firefox. All we've got to do is spell that right, there we go. Drop that into Firefox, and what are we going to see? Beautiful, oh, apple.com, isn't that amazing? And just to put them up there together. And yeah, part of the problem here is that are we relying on humans to look at this and make a trust decision on which one's legitimate or not? How does a human, most humans, look at the Apple one, the IDN one represented in Firefox with those characters and actually make a trust decision on this? Like, that is actually an enormously hard problem. So what happens then is we start the discussion about EV. And this is where I think it gets kind of interesting. So let's take Have I Been Pwned. And Have I Been Pwned does have an EV cert. And for clarity, I went and got the EV cert primarily because I just wanted to go through the process. Let's go, you know, run it up the flagpole, see how it goes. And in case you haven't gotten an EV cert recently, some of the things I needed to do for this was, first of all, if I wanted to see Have I Been Pwned, I needed a legal business entity called Have I Been Pwned. So I went and registered one in Australia. And then they said, okay, well, that entity, because it was a business name, not a proprietary limited company, and this will be an Australia-specific thing, they said it needs to be owned by an entity that has an Australian business number. So I had to go out and get an Australian business number. Now we see Have I Been Pwned, we see my name, we see AU, so we know that I run it in Australia. So if we see this, we've got complete confidence that it's actually me running a legit service. So this is good, right? I never know if everyone's just being quiet or if they just totally disagree with me. So let's try this. The commercial CAs can charge money for EV certs because EV certs do require more effort. So when I got this from DigiCert, I had to go through the process of submitting a bunch of information that humans verified. They even said, look, we need to have a Skype video conversation with you. We need you to hold your passport up next to your face, smile. We're going to take a photo of your face, passport. I spoke to a really nice human there. There is overhead in order to validate the identity of the entity. So I get that they have to charge money for it. A lot of the basis of their rationale for why EV makes sense is because if you see EV, you can have a high degree of confidence in the authenticity of the site. So you can trust it more. Conversely, if you don't see EV, you can trust it less because it could be a homograph style example. Now, as a bit of a test, let's try this. Assuming this is the case where we have greater degrees of confidence in EV than what we do DV, you would expect to see very large sites implementing EV. So by show of hands, let's just try a few of these. Who thinks Facebook uses EV? Jeremiah does. And Jeffrey. All right. What about DV? Who thinks Facebook's on DV? These numbers don't add up. But anyway, let's give it a go. So we'll fire over to Facebook. Now, let's load this up, and we'll see what we get on Facebook. Okay. So we've got DV. But the thing is that if you expected EV, so if you put your hand up and said EV, and then you went here and you saw DV, would you change your behavior? And this is where it gets kind of interesting. Okay, so what about eBay? Because we'll do something with money, right? Because a lot of people go, well, this is just social. Who thinks eBay has EV? Okay, more hands. Who thinks it has DV? Still doesn't add up, but regardless. All right, let's try this. So we're gonna jump over to eBay. What are we going to get on eBay? Here we go. All right. So DV again. And we have the same discussion. If you were going to go to eBay and buy something, and then you went there and you just saw secure and you didn't actually see like eBay Inc. in the visual indicator within Chrome, would you leave it? One more. What about Twitter? Who thinks Twitter has EV? No one wants to put their hand up now. Oh, just Jim. Okay. DV. Okay, a lot more. Let's give Twitter a go. Whoops, let's go back to the over there, Twitter. Slow internet makes suspenseful browsing. EV.
Yeah.
Now, here's the interesting thing with this. When I wrote that blog post I just showed you with Melee in it before, I had a screen cap, which was the top 10 websites in the world, and I had a screen cap at the corner of the browser, and every single one was DV. Twitter was on there. It was the 10th largest. And then I tweeted this, and a whole bunch of people were like, wow, this is amazing. And then a bunch of people said, well, hang on, I just checked on Twitter, and I saw EV. Why are they seeing EV and I'm seeing DV? And then this guy in Norway said, well, hang on, I see DV as well. And what I realized is depending on where you are in the world, you will get either EV or DV. And then the other thing I realized is that I travel around a lot to these different places and I use Twitter extensively every day and I had never noticed. And I look for this shit, right? So what do you think it's like for your average person? They've got no idea. Absolutely no idea. And, you know, to me, this is sort of like the killer argument of why it just doesn't make sense, because people are not looking for the absence of the indicator and changing their behavior as a result. Many of us here are security pros, and we didn't know, I didn't know, which ones had EV and which ones didn't. And then we take the whole thing even further. I'll give another good example. Some people have seen this. This did the rounds a little while ago. This is Safari on iOS, and this has an EV cert, and obviously it's Stripe. Now, what does Stripe do? Right, money. So if you go to this website, you know that you're on Stripe Inc., like the payment processor that handles money, yeah? Not so much enthusiasm. All right, let's open up Chrome on iOS and see what we see. Same site. And what's actually happened here is this bloke here, Ian Carroll, has gone and registered a company called Stripe in another state in the US. And he's gotten an EV certificate for Stripe.inc. Which is actually kind of awesome. Like I saw that and went, well, that's pretty cool. That's pretty ingenious. It didn't cost much either. So he managed to get an EV indication on a site representing a name that everyone had an association to, which was completely different to the site he was actually on. And I used this demo multiple times earlier this year, and then I went back to it only a few weeks ago, and the site had been shut down. Domain, or rather the certificate, had been revoked. And Ian's been trying to figure out why. So he tweeted the other day, he says, DigiCert says no, I can't have that. And part of their explanation was there were a couple of risk factors which were discovered and determined to be too high to proceed with issuance. No one can tell him what the risk factors were. They just revoked the certificate. And when they say proceed with issuance, what they really mean is we're taking it away from you. You already have it. We're taking it away. We can't tell you why. But there were risk factors. And some people speculated about what those risk factors may be. And I'm not saying whether that's necessarily wrong or right. But I do find it interesting that it was revoked, and they don't have to tell you why. Now, there's one other thing I thought we'd touch on with EV. And I'll give you a really good example here. This is a cert reseller. And the folks behind this have been rather vocal about the value of EV, and you should have EV, and Let's Encrypt is phishing. In fact, they've written blog posts about Let's Encrypt just enables phishing. And this is their site, SSL Store. We know it's the SSL store because there's a big logo that says SSL store. The domain says SSL store. This is the SSL store. You can have confidence if you go here. If you were to see an EV cert, it would tell you that it's the SSL store and you could trust it, right? But it's not the SSL store. And you're looking at this just going, I'm really confused now. I don't know who to trust because the whole thing is actually getting really hard. And here's the takeaway from all this, and this is maybe one of the most sort of insightful things I think I have in this talk, which is that the security controls that rely on the absence of positive visual indicators don't work. And this is precisely what EV is. You should have EV. If you don't see it, do something different. But we don't know whether it should exist or not. And this makes it enormously hard, even for us, as a room full of a lot of security professionals to look at these indicators and make a value decision. What do you think it's like for the average person? They still think it's a freaking handbag. How are they going to make a decision like this? So, you know, last thing to sort of end on a little bit of a lighter note. One of the things that I spoke about earlier on is the representation of hacking. And I think we probably all see a lot of stuff on the news and a lot of stuff even represented by security companies where they talk about hackers and we go, that's not how it works. You know, or this is hyperbole, or this is something which is just totally non-representative of how the industry is. And recently I thought it would be kind of fun just to go and see if we can establish what it is that people think the hackers are. And a quick Google Images search does show some trends. And you kind of look at this and go, well, what do we know about hackers? So what are the trends here with hackers? Hoodies, very good. Green screens, we saw that before. We know that's hackers. And we see this imagery over and over again. And on a sort of a slightly more serious note, if we take a moment to say, why do we see this sort of representation? It's scary, right? And when you think about what we see on the press, a lot of it is scary headlines. Plane blown up, terrorists attacking, like whatever it is. If they can make it hyperbolic and they can make it scary and frightening, people will read these things. But very often we see the same thing with security companies. So we're seeing security companies try to play on fear in order to sell a product. The more we can scare people about what will happen to them, the more stuff we can sell them. And I saw one recently. It was a company that makes a product called Cujo. And the value proposition of Cujo is hackers are trying to get into your things, put this device in your home, no more hackers. Right? Problem solved. I've got a really small part of the clip here for when they launch the product. I want to show you this.
You may not know it, but you've probably already been hacked. Thousands of hacking attacks occur each day.
Now, how do we know he's a hacker? Hoodie? Very good. So it's like, tick that, green screen, tick that. But when I was looking at this, I was like, this feels odd, right? I was like, all right, what we'll do is I'll go back and I'll kind of zoom and enhance on the corner of the screen, because the way it looked to me is it feels like a browser. And I look at it and go, why is this guy like green screen hacking in a browser? And I worked it out, and I want to share this with you, because to me this is like the perfect example of the way this industry is so often represented. This guy is using a service which you can find at hackertyper.net. And the way hackertyper.net works is you go to the website and then you just mash the keyboard and it hacks for you. And this is what they're using to sell Cujo. What they don't show you is while you're hacking away, and you know, you can get your friends over or whatever and say, hey, look, I'm going to hack Pentagon, whatever it is. And you're hacking away and you try to hack in. Oh, it didn't work, right? So you hack a little bit more. Hey, amazing, I'm in. And this is the way the product is being sold. And on that slightly serious but hopefully lighter note as well, thank you very much for having me. Do we have time for questions? Like, a couple of minutes? Here, go. So for those who didn't hear, I think it was less a question and more an acknowledgement that EV has a verification process, and when organisations like Symantec don't do their verification properly, bad things happen, as they have since happened to Symantec. Was there actually a question component of that, or was it more kind of an acknowledgement that... Right, okay, so EV as a concept is not broken, EV as a process is broken. I think the concept of identity verification is good. I would like to be able to reliably know what is the real Netflix site and what is the Netflix phishing site. I think what's broken is the way it's represented to people visually, because we can't rely on padlocks and logos and things like that. The model at the moment, even for us in this room, like we just established that we don't know which is the real site and which is not in terms of EV.